It's always a great pleasure to me being in this Richard Dahl's lectures. I have been in several years before. It is a great honor also, and only reminding the presence of Richard Dahl in the spirit of these lectures is a great encouragement to me. What I'm going to do today is try to go over the project, the InterCOVID project that we launched last year to try to answer a specific question about the effect of COVID infection during pregnancy. This is an interesting times because we went through the whole process of organizing a project and implemented and analyzing and publishing, which normally takes about 5 years, 10 years, in about 10 months. Therefore, this is an extraordinary experience, and I'm going to try to go over the beginning on the process of launching an international multicenter study in such a short period of time. During the next, we were confronted early next year. Next, Gam. We were confronted early last year that basically in February 2020, that the epidemic was rapidly spreading. They were concerned about the effect in pregnancy because the previous SARS and MERS epidemics. And as always in the beginning of these new health situations, there were very limited information on pregnancy. There were large number of studies, interesting. There were 51 studies published in February 2020, of which only 8 were not overlapping cases. They are mostly cases were published in different formats. And then there were a very small number of cases, ranging from 20 to around 50 cases. Then the situation was very unstable. People were worried. The general feeling at that time was that COVID didn't have that much of effect during pregnancy, but the epidemic was spreading all over. Next. Then there was a clear need for a study, international study, covering fast and covering large populations. There were few evidences and concerns about pregnant women all over the world that there will be transmission of the SARS-CoV-2 virus to the uterus, to the fetus. There were few evidences also in neonatal infection, but still a few cases reported. Well, there was only one study of these 51 that I mentioned that have some sort of a control group, including only 16 confirmed cases. And then there was a bunch of ongoing registries of cases in which they didn't have any, or didn't have attempts to control, or the comparisons were done with non-pregnant populations. Then there was a very important demand for launching these large studies. Next. Then the main issue was to launch a study in which we can compare COVID-19 pregnant women with COVID-19 in non-pregnant women. That was the more or less the general approach. Women were comparing pregnant women with no pregnant women. We thought at that time, in early March, there would be a real need to go to have a reference population of pregnant women. Next. Then by March 2020, the WHO characterized the COVID-19 infection as a pandemic. We started literature review that had to complete it in a month. We were already ongoing literature review process. We prepared an inter-COVID protocol, and then contacted all the Intergrowth 21st network, that is our normal research network in which we have conducted the previous set of studies in related to fetal growth and preterm birth, and demanded or requested information of the interest that they could have with and the health authorities of the different countries to participate in a multinational study exploring this pandemic. Interestingly enough, in many places did not have enough cases or did not have even a system of testing. By March 2020, they were still in the beginning of the processing of testing different test strategies. Then there was some sort of a hesitation about where we're going to present, where we're going to participate in a study in which we don't have cases, and it's not clear what is going to happen in the future. Then, unfortunately, the evidence were clear that there will be cases in most of these countries, and the epidemic was running high in northern Italy and Spain. And there was very high risk of large exposure of pregnant women to the virus. Then next, we went over our standard data collection forms that we use in most of the studies we prepare, adapted these forms to the new information that was required for these projects. Package all these forms and distribute it electronically to the potential candidates and centers. Next. That included all the standard forms. And then because the only reason that we were able to move that fast, because we have already most of these forms in place and most of the centers or the main centers were already trained and we were part of the electronic data entry system. And next. As I said, we have a real-time data entry management system already in place in most of the centers, or at least the large institutions, which made possible that immediately they could start piloting and entering data. We have already in place some sort of a website that we updated and make it specifically to this project, in which all the centers could get the information, download the forms, print the forms, and then we have in place this data collection system already set up. Then we were lucky that at that time everything was more or less in place, has to be adapted. Refocus, but the full infrastructure was almost ready by the end of April. Next, by the end of April, the protocol was ready. Was discussed last time. Changes were made, and I think the protocol now is dated 23rd of April 2020. We were ready to go start data collection almost even less than 2 months since we started thinking the study. And by the 24th of April, the university was kind enough to post in the official webpage of the university next that the study was going to starting. Then by the almost the end of April 2020, we were ready to go to the field and start collecting cases and non-positive women tested and the corresponding controls. At that time, we are still really impressed about the capacity of all these multi sites and different countries and health authorities to manage to go through the different steps and approvals and authorizations. And I think we are grateful to the effort made by the university, particularly by the health authorities of all these 18 countries that were part of the study to make the approval, the corresponding approvals so fast. Then by the 24th of April, the study started last year, no? The study started, next. And basically, the next. This is the INTERCOVID is a large, as I said, multinational, multi-site, prospective cohort study with the aim of assessing the effect of COVID-19 in pregnancy on maternal, fetal, neonatal outcomes worldwide, compared basically with women, pregnant women that were not diagnosed with COVID-19. Then this is a study that we aim to implement, and that was implemented, as I said, by starting by the 8th of April 2020. Then basically there were basically two groups of women that went to study. The diagnosed pregnant women, that is, and is called diagnosed because these are the pregnant women that were they were diagnosed following one of these four possibilities at that time, and compared with women that were not diagnosed. And I want to explain why there were women that were not diagnosed at that time, in which was not testing was not universal to all pregnant women. Therefore, there were women that were not diagnosed or having the infection. Then diagnosed pregnant women, as I said, when we started this in March 2020, were women that have laboratory confirmed COVID-19. Then because there was no universal availability in many places, the tests were not easily available. We also included at the beginning any patient that have radiological pulmonary findings suggesting COVID-19, and also because we're worried at the beginning that may not be enough cases with laboratory confirmation of the infections, we also consider having women that have two symptoms compatible with COVID-19. Also, at the beginning, in the original protocol, we thought that it may be necessary to include women that even without symptoms were in very close interaction with the persons with confirmed COVID-19. That item four, when the project started, and there was evidence that we have more cases that we were expecting, that was dropped, but that was initially in the protocol. Then we consider that women that we consider diagnosed or having COVID-19, laboratory confirmation, radiological confirmation, and two of the list of classic symptoms compatible with the COVID-19. Obviously, when the data collection started and the laboratory tests were available worldwide, the percentage of these three items were changing, and the study ended up with a large majority of cases enrolled laboratory confirmed. Then the non-diagnosed pregnant women, that means that women that were asymptomatic and did not have any evidence having COVID-19, they were recruited at the same time, concomitant, immediately during the antenatal period, immediately after the case that was diagnosed, during the antenatal period, during hospital admission or at birth, with a 2-to-1 ratio, two non-diagnosed women to one diagnosed. The key issue is that they were all at the same level of care, and also they were at the same level of care of the women involved in the as diagnosed. Then the idea was, in simple terms, to have women that have enough evidence that were infected and compare with pregnant women that did not have these evidences, that were recruited at the same time, concomitant, following the identification of the case, at the same level of care, antenatal care, intrapartum, and admission for complications, and also at the same study site. And the main objective, as you can imagine, of this strategy was to reduce the selection bias. Now, the next outcomes to study, we move, because at that time we didn't know that much of the incidence or prevalence of the outcomes that we may find. We adopted a series of three indexes that we normally use to summarize perinatal events in most of our studies. That is a maternal morbidity and mortality index that includes a series of any of the conditions listed below, and admission intensive care unit, or death, or referred to higher level of care. This is an unweighted index that allows us to summarize the severity of maternal conditions. Then a severe neonatal morbidity index that is basically a compound of severe newborn conditions immediately during the neonatal period. The same index plus newborn admission to intensive care units and the order is form part of the severe perinatal morbidity and mortality index, and then preeclampsia and preterm birth specifically separated from these indices because there were evidences or suspicions that maybe there is a specific effect on preeclampsia and preterm birth. And as a secondary outcomes, all these individual components of the three indices. Then the idea was to be open to any surprise in the possible effect on different outcomes, but also have the possibility to summarize and try to get an answer in a relatively short period of time. We aim it to collect data during 2020. Next. We did some estimation of sample size. We have our collaborators in the School of Public Health at the University of California at Berkeley. There's a data management and data analysis group that has been traditionally working with us, and estimated, as you can imagine, with all the imprecisions of this type of estimations, that any outcome that will increase from 10% to 15%, thinking in things like a preterm birth or any of these composite outcomes, with about 500 exposed women or diagnosed women and a 2-to-1 ratio of 1,000 non-exposed or non-diagnosed women, will give us a reasonable power to detect the differences between 10 to 15%. Obviously, unfortunately, as the pandemic expanded more and start covering larger populations, particularly in northern Italy and France, we were able to recruit larger numbers than expected at the beginning of the study. Then this is we have a priori analysis plan with the idea of trying to have even dummy tables ready. We have by June 2020 all the dummy tables ready that to allow us, as soon as we decide to stop the study, to populate these dummy tables and get an analysis a priori decided. Then we evaluate the primary and secondary outcomes, comparing diagnosed with non-diagnosed women. We adjusted always by country, calendar or month of the study at the study entry, as the epidemic changes rapidly in many of these countries, maternal age, maternal morbidity, baseline maternal morbidity. For preterm birth, that was one of our main outcomes. We all try to adjust by previous preterm birth. And then we study associations between exposed or diagnosed or maternal morbidity index expressed as a binary outcomes, relative risk, and so on. We did a stratified analysis by symptoms, asymptomatic and symptomatic, and baseline characteristics, and possibly morbidity and mortality morbidity, pre-pregnancy morbidity, and also pre-pregnancy weight, as there were evidences of the effect of obesity in non-pregnant subjects. Then with this strategy in at hand, I think for at least for our standards and for the standards of the bureaucratic process in many of our institutions, was a record achieving all these organizations in such a short period of time. Then we went to the field. We conducted extensive Zoom meetings with all the collaborators around the world, and managed to complete the study by November 2020. Next, this is an interesting situation. The study was basically based in 18 countries in 43 study sites. As I said, most of the study sites were already part of the Intergrowth network, already part of the network, collaborating with the university in several places. And then there was a relatively easy process of implementation, because these people were already part of our active network, and also there were some of them, there were large institutions with very familiar with the research, large scale collaborative research. This you have here the distribution, and as you can see, there is a process of expansion of the centers from what was at the beginning the center of epidemic, as I said, in Europe, and particularly northern part of southern Europe, then West Africa, and then with the epidemic start moving to the US and to Mexico and Brazil, our centers in these places started activating. Obviously, we have centers in the East also, Egypt, India, and then we managed to have a good representation across different hemispheres, but also following the dynamic of the epidemic. Next. Now, at the end of the day, we enrolled 2,130 women, of which 706 were diagnosed as COVID-19, and 1,424 were not diagnosed as having COVID-19. Next. Of this, as I said, because of the dynamic of the epidemic, of the 706, 656 were confirmed, laboratory confirmed cases, as the tests were becoming more available in across all the different countries that participated, and about 50 of these women were recruited only for symptoms. We decided to do sensitivity analysis with these women, but we decided to keep these women within the population for all analysis, for all complete analysis, because they were enrolled by definition in the protocol at the time in May, June 2020. We didn't know about what will be how fast will be the distribution of the laboratory tests across different countries. Then this was the decision to retain them in all the analysis, despite that they were only symptomatic and didn't have laboratory confirmation. Then from this group of confirmed cases, next, confirmed cases, they were antigen positive women, the great majority, antibody positive, a very small and very small group of radiological. But again, all because of the original protocol included that this will be the diagnosis. We keep all these cases together and this confirm the diagnosis of COVID positive diagnosed women. And in the non-diagnosed women, next, these women, as I said before, did not have any evidence of COVID positivity or the virus positivity, but these women, not because were not universal testing, obviously cannot be excluded. That some of these women could have been asymptomatic positive women. Interesting enough, we were not that much concerned about that bias because that bias will move to a more conservative estimation, as there was some sort of degree of contamination in the control group, if you will. Therefore, we were comfortable that contamination will provide us perhaps some sort of advice toward a more conservative approach, which is that our results should be interpreted as a minimum effect that could be observed by the infection. Interesting enough, of this group, there were more overweight women in the diagnosed. There were less smokers in the diagnosed group as compared with the non-diagnosed, and there were more history of preterm birth, stillbirth, neonatal death, and previous medical condition among women that were diagnosed with COVID-19. Interesting enough, 44% of these women that were considered positive were asymptomatic. Therefore, allow us to compare the effect of symptomatic and asymptomatic groups within the diagnosed women. Next. Now, this is the summary of the results that I think has given strong evidences of the effect of COVID-19 during pregnancies. The maternal morbidity, these are all relative risk, adjusted relative risk. The vertical y-axis is the different outcomes that we have I listed before. The maternal morbidity and mortality index increases, is all statistically significant, except the small for gestational age. COVID-19 compared with women, pregnant women without COVID-19 or without a clinical diagnosis or laboratory confirmation, they have an increase of maternal morbidity index, have an increase of preeclampsia, have an increase of infection, particularly respiratory infection, as you can imagine, have an increase of almost 5 times in admission to intensive care unit, have an increase of maternal death, a large effect of maternal death with an odds ratio of almost 22. Have a double risk of preterm delivery. Have increase of loss of weight as expected. No effect of small for gestational age, as can be expected because this is an acute condition that doesn't have enough time to affect fetal growth. Has an increased risk of almost 3 times severe neonatal morbidity. And then have an increase twice the risk of severe perinatal mortality and morbidity index. Therefore, overall, it is clear that COVID-19 during pregnancy, as compared with pregnant women without diagnosis of COVID-19, is not a good idea and should be avoided or should be tried to be avoided, infection during pregnancy, and the evidence is that they affect mostly maternal morbidity and their conditions, their complications, particularly preeclampsia, that we have studied in more details, and neonatal outcomes. And through neonatal outcomes, particularly preterm delivery and loss of weight, affects morbidity and mortality during the neonatal period. Therefore, that is a summary of the results, rather important in our opinion. And fortunately, and I think I'm going to go a little bit more in detail, that has led in perhaps record times to influence medical practices and the patterns of vaccination in many countries in which women now are considered to as pregnancy alone a factor to for a priority for immunization. Next. Then the next question, and now I'm going to go over a series of slides on the different interpretation of the information. Next. Then the first question is about symptoms. Then what is the effect? What is the relationship with severity? Symptoms as a measure of severity. Here, these are relative risk, also adjusted relative risk, comparing with women without COVID, these are with the reference population, and the blue is the women asymptomatic, and the red the symptomatic. There is a clear indication, as you can see, there is not much of a mystery here, that asymptomatic women have a mild disease, and the complications are very limited, or if any. And the most of the effect is on symptomatic women. Obviously, as nobody knows who is going to be symptomatic or not symptomatic when you get the infection, this has more sort of a strategic or referral system, but prevention is the same because it's impossible to identify who is going to have symptoms or not, other than the normal risk factors known for this disease. But in general, one can say that the asymptomatic women will pass this condition without any major complication, except for preeclampsia. And that is where the issue is, an interesting issue emerges. Symptoms doesn't seem to affect much the effect of COVID on preeclampsia. Therefore, our interpretation is that maybe the association between COVID-19 and preeclampsia are more related to other pathophysiological processes rather than the overt symptomatology of the respiratory conditions, or this is more a generalized disease. And this is a more generalized disease that will affect a woman that already have somehow the preeclamptic process already operating. Then symptomatology, not much effect except for preeclampsia, where the effect is seen in both symptomatic and asymptomatic. The next one is more or less the same analysis, but focuses on preterm birth. And here is a different picture than with preeclampsia. These are Kaplan-Meier's cures. As you can see, the black is the COVID non-diagnosed, or the reference group, if you will. The yellow are the diagnosed but asymptomatic, and the blue is the diagnosed symptomatic. And it's clear that the proportion of early preterms starting more or less by 30 weeks clearly shows a pattern oriented to early birth all across from starting by approximately 30 weeks of or mostly on women with a COVID-19 diagnosed and symptomatic. The asymptomatic will have a limited effect. And next, please. Then the question was about the neonatal infection. What happened with the neonatal infection? Neonatal infections, we have 416 neonates born to women COVID-19, diagnosed before 48 hours. We find about 13% of the PCR positive of these neonates, all from women, positive women. At that time, it was considered a very high rate. This is in November, December 2020. Normally, previous reports have been reporting 1, 2, 3%. We consider this because was a larger testing and because this was the general population with inductions, cesarean sections, and so on. That even it was very high, was a more estimation. Time has proved that this is a realistic estimation of infections about around 10%, 13%. When we stratify by cesarean delivery, we find that the cesarean birth was a factor in the neonatal period. There were far more women born from babies born through cesarean section than in the tested positive, that those that tested negative, almost double risk. This is an interesting observation. We don't know if it's a contamination or obviously more severe cases receive more a cesarean section because maternal indications or fetal indications, and that increases the risk of contamination at different levels. The good news for the clinical practice is that there is no association with exclusive breastfeeding during the early neonatal period. Therefore, as suspected, because the virus doesn't cross the human milk, and if hygiene is applied and protection mask and so on are implemented, the early feeding to a positive mother does not increase the risk of the neonatal infection. Next, the other issue that was in discussion was about preeclampsia. What is the association with preeclampsia? Then, this is an expansion, what I showed you before. Shows COVID infections stratified by parity, and you see that there is not much effect. It is more in a disease association with nulliparous, and like a preeclampsia is a disease of nulliparity, but there is not much effect of symptoms. Therefore, this is a confirmation of an increased risk of general diseases operating. Next. And this is I wanted to show this because give a more idea of the interaction between preeclampsia and COVID. This is a Kaplan-Meier analysis again on the time of COVID diagnosis, divided, stratified by preeclampsia and no preeclampsia. As you can see, the women without preeclampsia get infected with COVID or get tested with COVID proportionally increasing all over the gestational period without any specific timing. But the women that have preeclampsia, and we assume that the preeclampsia symptoms are were before the COVID infection, because COVID infection were mostly later in pregnancy, and preeclampsia is a disease that already operating between 20 to 23, 24 weeks early in pregnancy. The women that have preeclampsia or already operating with symptoms or without symptoms, these women tend to have a peak of a COVID infection starting by 30 weeks of gestation, which is an interesting combination because that is a period in which preeclampsia develops or start developing a more marked pathophysiological condition. Then I thought it would be interesting for you to look at this because it seems to have a relationship that could, in our opinion, be preeclampsia as an additional risk factor for having COVID-19. Next, I'm going to show one thing more. Or next, pass the next one. And the next one. I want to show this also because it's an intriguing association that I want to mention for you to possible discussion or consideration, is the association between gestational diabetes, insulin, the use of insulin, pre-pregnancy, DM, obesity, and COVID. And then this is the different categories that we have the possibility to analyze. And you can see overweight women. I'm going from the top to the bottom of this horizontal. These are all ratios. Then the COVID-19, women with overweight women have an increased risk of COVID-19, about 20%, with a ratio 1.2. Then women, gestational diabetic alone among normal women doesn't have any effect. But gestational diabetic without insulin, but among overweight or obese, have an increased risk of 34%, as you can see with an R ratio 1.34. Then more severe gestational diabetic that require insulin, even if they have normal weight, have an increase of 1.8, the other ratios, or adjusted relative risk. Then gestational diabetic with insulin and overweight have an increased risk of 1.77, and history of diabetic mellitus, history only, have a double risk of COVID. Therefore, they seem to be an association during pregnancy for both history of diabetics and gestational diabetic. And that gestational diabetic is a dose effect relationship, if you will, with severity of the GDM. And we find that this is an interesting association, also confirming the known association in non-pregnant subjects. Next one. In summary, maternal morbidity, COVID-19 diagnosis during pregnancy increases risk of maternal morbidity and mortality, severe neonatal morbidity index, the severe perinatal morbidity and mortality index, maternal mortality, preeclampsia, and preterm birth when compared with women pregnant individuals without COVID-19 diagnosis. And the conclusion for preeclampsia, next, is preeclampsia is independently associated with COVID-19 in pregnancy, is associated independently and in additive fashion with an increased risk of preterm birth, severe perinatal morbidity and mortality index, and the composite adverse maternal outcomes. It seems to be a strong risk factor for SARS-CoV-2 infection and its related complications. We don't think that COVID-19 is etiologically associated with preeclampsia. We think that it's preeclampsia underlying conditions to increase the risk of COVID-19. Next. Then finally, finally, we published these results in May 2021, roughly exactly 1 year later. But interesting, I just want to mention this paper was ready in December 2020. We packaged the paper in the normal strategy, and even in the middle of the epidemic, with many, many cases being reported in pregnant women, there was a big discussion about what to do in terms of immunization for pregnant women. We submitted very highly motivated, and I think we have a good track record of publications. And then the paper was immediately rejected without peer review in two leading journals. Without peer review, it was considered it was not even worth to be considered for peer review. We were honestly surprised, considering the large amount of papers published on maternal complications or case reports of newborns and so on. Then we were a little bit concerned, and we're still discussing what was the rationale for delaying the publication of this paper for almost a month and a half and refusing to send to peer review. It still is a subject for publication strategy, but I just mentioned because we were really surprised of this reaction. Then we sent it to JAMA and was referred to JAMA Pediatrics and published in May. Has had a massive coverage in the press, and we are very happy that has contributed to in several countries put pregnant women at the risk or the priority level for vaccinations. I think with this, I'm going to stop here. Finally, can I have the next, next, please? No, the next one. In a way to contribute to the continuing medical education and also to provide some feedback to the general health practitioners in all the countries that participated with us. We develop an e-learning course free of charge that is available in our webpage that was targeted to the participant centers and participant countries, but obviously it's open to anybody that summarizes what is an updated version of the situation of COVID-19 in pregnancy during the delivery and the neonatal period and recommendations from WHO and other agencies that can be downloaded and a course taken and a certificate obtained if you pass the exam. We have a series of these early courses. This is in collaboration with the Global Health Network of the university. But I think this is something that the people, the general practitioners, nurses, doctors, physicians can benefit. And with this, I stop here and then happy to hear any of your reactions. Thank you.